Insight. The first ever series to analyze the unexplored aspects and issues of Carnatic music. Dear Rasikas, welcome to the 15th episode of our Insight series. I'm very happy to share that we've had an overwhelming response to our previous episodes, and I hope you continue extending your patronage to us. In the last episode, we had discussed about compositions and how they really enrich our Carnatic music. In this context, I would like to share that what is it that really inspires somebody to compose? Now, if you look at a painter, that is an artist, he expresses his imagination by creating various pictures. Again, you see that the linguist, he plays with words and creates poetry. A sculptor, for example, chisels to create beautiful statues for us. Similarly, we see that there have been many who have composed compositions in terms of giving vent to their emotions and imaginations. Now, in the context of our own Carnatic music, whom would we call a composer? A composer is called a Vagyakara in our Carnatic music, in the Indian context that I mean. Vagyakara means, Vag means one who composes the lyrics, Gaya is the music, and one who is a composer of the music as well as the lyrics is called a Vagyakara. It is interesting to note here that we have had so many musicians over several periods of time. But not everybody is a composer in that sense, because they may have performed great music, they may be very imaginary in their perception of the music itself, but they do not compose. Again, we also see that there have been many Vagyakaras who have not been really great performers. So that comes to the point that composing is a very, very innate and a very, very exclusive ability that happens within somebody to give us good compositions. Also in this context, I would like to share that in our system of music, we see that some are able to compose the lyrics and the music simultaneously. That is, both come out simultaneously as an outpour. And classic examples, of course, of this are our Trinity, Sri Tyagarajar, Sri Dreekshadar, Sri Shyama Sastri, and later on Sri Papanasam Sivan, and so on. We also see in our system, or rather I would say that amusingly sometimes, many people come and give me books saying that I have composed songs, where you see that they have really composed something like a Pallavi, Anupallavi, Charanam, a set of lyrics. And on top of it, you just have a mention of the name of the ragam as, this is Ragam Kambodhi, Ragam Kalyani, Ragam Todi, and so on. From this, how do we really decipher what is the intention of the composer in terms of the melodic buildup of that particular composition? You can never know. So obviously, if somebody has written a song, just the lyrics, Pallavi, Anupallavi, and Charanam, and put on top of it a Kambodhi, the same Kambodhi can be interpreted as a musical form to set that music in different ways by different people. So that does not really serve any purpose, and that cannot be, you cannot really call them a great Vagyakara in that sense. And of course, in our system, we do not have, like in film music, sometimes you see that some people set the tune, that is the mettu, and then after that the lyrics is composed to that. So that is something very peculiar to the film music where it happens. But in our Carnatic music, we see that a composition, a good composition, is where the composer has himself written the lyrics, he has tuned it, and also we see that he has put a particular thalam, and as the whole musical composition is done. Of course, we also see that sometimes there are lyrics and somebody else sets the tune to it, and then somehow the two blend very beautifully and they become very, very popular. This can be said of many of the Ashtapadis, Tarangams and other things where we do not have the original music, but then some other person has tuned them, but yet the two have blended seamlessly so well that the composition turns out to be very, very beautiful. As I mentioned earlier also, a composition is very, very important in the context of our music because it freezes the raga for posterity in the sense that it is an expression of a musical idea. And here again also, I would like to again mention the fact that we have had a variety of compositions like Padam, Javali, Kriti, Varnam, Geetam and so many other forms being composed by composers. This again, of course, I also said that through each of these compositional forms, we are able to capture a particular aspect of the ragam, and that's why we've had also so many varieties. Coming to the composition and its classification, just for the interest of Rasikas, I would like to share that we have two categories, what we call as the Abhyasaganam and Sabhaganam. Abhyasaganam in the sense that those preliminary exercises which have to be practiced by a student to gain proficiency in music. And Sabhaganam includes all the compositions which are performed exclusively as part of the concert. Now, what do we mean by Abhyasaganam? What are the exercises or what are the components which form a part of Abhyasaganam? Obviously, the Sarali, Janta, Alankaram, the Dhatu Varsa, these are all a part of the Abhyasaganam, where practicing all these swaravalis gives some kind of a control over the swarasthanas for the student. For example, when we start with the Sarali Varsa, Sari ga ma pa da ni sa sa ni da pa ma ga ri sa, then we teach the child to sing it in three speeds to give them some kind of a laya gyanam. Sari ga ma pa da ni sa sa ni da pa ma ga ri sa, Sari ga ma pa da ni sa sa ni da pa ma ga ri sa, Sari ga ma pa da ni sa sa ni da pa ma ga ri sa, Sari 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 ga ma. Like this it goes on. I'm sure all of you would have heard children singing this as part of their practice or the guru teaching it to students. Then the cognizance of janta and other things are very, very essential to give a wider dimension to the scope of this ragam. And we all know that Mayamalagala has formed the base, as far as we know, for all these preliminary lessons. Of course, later on now we also see, I have in fact talked to a few musicians who feel that more than Mayamalagala, its Shankarabharanam probably would be a better choice, in the sense that in Mayamalagala we see that the spacing between the swaras is very, very minimal, and sometimes the students finds it difficult to have a cognizance of that small space, whereas in Shankarabharanam we see that the spacing between the swaras is much wider, in the sense, just to show you, Sa Ri Ga Ma Pa Da Ni Sa Sa Ni Ta Pa Ma Ga Ri Sa, where you see that Sa Ri is one pair, Ga Ma Pa Da Ni Sa, where the Sa and Ri are very close to each other. Similarly, the Pa, Dha and the Ni Sa, the spacing is very less. Whereas when you see in Shankarabharanam, Sa Ri Ga Ma Pa Dha Ni Sa Sa Ni Dha Pa Ma Ga Ri Sa, though some gurus have really used Shankarabharanam to teach the preliminary exercises, but overall we see that by and large still we follow the Mayamalagala as the base for teaching the preliminary lessons to the students. Now, after all these swara exercises are over, we need to initiate the children into more of the sahitya aspect also. We first had the ragam and the talam. Now the next element which comes into the fold is the sahityam. And that is where the first composition that we see that is composed in Carnatic music, which is a blend of raga, tala and the sahitya, is the Geetam. Though Geetam does not form a part of the concert music, it would be interesting to see its structure in the sense that how it is different from the other forms that we present in a concert. A Geetam, first of all, is set to a particular ragam, a particular talam, and it has a sahityam, as I mentioned earlier. Now, what are the salient features? The first thing is, of course, that it has a very simple melody. That is, there are no complicated sangatis, there are not durita kala phrases, that is, the male kala phrases are not there. So it is a uniform kind of a tempo that is maintained throughout, and it has got a very, very simple structure in it. Let us sing one Geetam to see how it sounds. Also, you will see that here, unlike a Kriti or a Varnam, which has got different segments, that is, you have the bifurcation in terms of Pallavi, Anupallavi and Charanam in a Kriti, or in a Varnam you have a Purvangam and an Uttarangam. Here it is a continuous flow of the song, and only when the whole thing is sung, the song gets complete. So it is just one particular unit that is happening throughout, and you don't really pause in between the intermediary sections. The most popular one is Sriganannatha. We'll just sing and see it for you to understand it better. And also, before I go into the song, would like to mention that the first few Geetams that are composed are in Malahari Ragam, which is a Janya of Mayamalagala, and Purandaradasa has opted to choose that particular Ragam, where you see the Arona is Sarima Padesa Sadapa Magarisa Shri Gananata Sinduravarna Karuna Sagara Karivadana Lambodhara Lakumikara Ambasuta Amaravinuta Lambodhara Lakumikara Siddha Charana. Like this, there are three stanzas and they continue one after the other. And you also see that this particular composition is in Rupaka Talam. After that, we have the Tishra Triputa coming into the fold, where you see Keraya Niranu Kerege Chaldi Varava Padetava Randikaniro. Also here, the most important thing is about how every swara probably has one syllable to it, and sometimes for two syllables, that is the elongation, you may have two swaras there, but seldom you see. For example, again we'll do it. Keraya niranu kerege challi. Or another example. Padumanabha Paramapurusha Paranjogoti. Like this. If you take the Kalyani Geetam again, for example, the same thing you will see. To show you the difference, I'll just explain it. Kamala Jadala Vimala Sunayana Karivarada Karunabu Deye. So for one beat you have only one swaram, This is quite different from, for example, if you take a Kirtana in Kalyani. He madri sute pahi varade paradevate. He madri sute pahi varade paradevate. He madri. So within one particular beat itself, you will see that there are male kala swaras, kir kala swaras, that is a mixture of different kala pramanas. Whereas when you talk about the Geetam, we see that it is in a very uniform kind of a tempo, and every beat will have only one swara as part of it. So this is the way in which, first of all, the children are initiated into the composition through the Geetam. And after the Geetam, we see that there are many more compositions, like we have the Swarajati and Jati Swaram. Now in Geetam again, what is the language that is used? Mainly we see that the Geetas are in Kannadam and Sanskrit. And Kannadam, of course, since Purandaradasa is himself a Kannada composer, we see that many of his compositions are in Kannada. And this group of compositions that he has composed as part of the Geetam are also collectively known as the Pillari Geetas. So when you talk about the Pillari Geetas, you understand these are the set of Geetas that form a part of it. And what is the theme of these compositions? We see that they are mainly on the deities, and for example, it may be on Vinayaka, it may be on Vishnu, it may be on Maheshwara, and so on. And here I would like to share the important composers. Of course, we did talk about Purandaradasa, but we also have Sri Paidala Gurumurthy Shastri, Sri Venkatamaki, and Ramamathya, who also composed many very, very useful Geetam for children. In this context, we also have something very interesting called the Lakshana Geetam, where you see that in the, as against the normal Geetam, the Lakshana Geetam serves a very, very important purpose, in the sense that within the composition itself, the composer tries to give you the Lakshana of the Ragam. For example, if there is a Lakshana Geetam in Hamsadvani, probably the Lakshana Geetam would give you an idea of what are the basic Arohana Aruna of that particular scale, what are the varieties of notes taken by it, whether it's a Bhashanga Raga, whether it's an Ubhanga Raga, whether it's an Audava Raga, whether it's a Melagartha Raga. So many details are provided by Lakshana Geetams, and that's where they are very, very important. Today, of course, you may ask, when we have so much of audio material available, why do we need Lakshana Geetams? Lakshana Geetams were very, very useful at a time when printing was not in vogue, and the oral tradition was the only way of transmission. So the way to really crystallize the form of that particular ragam and see that it doesn't deviate from that, for that a good composition which explains the entire lakshana of the particular ragam actually served a very good purpose, in the sense that it was able to codify the ragam through the composition at a time when printing was not the means, that is when you did not have a printed material to give us an understanding of what the lakshanam of the ragam is. With this, we come to the end of this episode, where we discussed something about the compositional form called Geetam and what are its salient features. If you do have any more questions or also your feedback, please do feel free to WhatsApp or email to us. I'm happy to share that many Rasikas have been listening intently to our episodes of the Insight series, and some have also responded by asking some questions. Today, I'd just like to take up one of these questions for explaining, where one Rasika has asked why we sing ragas like Nadanamakriya, Senjuruti, Punnagavarali, etc. in the Madhyama Shruti. What is the reason? Well, let us take up first Nadanamakriya, which is a janya of Maya Malava Gaula, and you see that it takes the Arona Avarona as Sarigama Padani Nidapamagarisa. Now, how is it different from Mayamalagula? First of all, in the sense that its range is very, very limited. That is, Mayamalagula takes the three sthais into consideration when it is sung. For example, Pa-da-ni-sa-ri-ga-ma-pa-da-ni-sa-ri-ga-ma-pa. You can go till the Tarasthai, Mandrasthai, and the middle, all the three octaves are encompassed. Whereas, when you take Nadanama Kriya, you see that it has got a very limited range, that is, its maximum note is Sa-ri-ga-ma-pa-da-ni-ni-da-pa-ma-ga-ri-sa. So, you don't sing the Tarasthai here, your limit is only till the Nishada. Now, I will sing the same composition, a very popular composition of Tyagaraja, Karuna Jalade Dasharate. I will sing it in the Madhyam Shruti first. Basically, what is the reason is that when you sing it in the Madhyama Shruti, it sounds brighter. That's the only reason. In the sense that because the range is limited, when you're shifting the sa and making the ma as your sa, then what happens is that it sounds a bit more brighter. That's all. Now, if you sing the same thing, Karuna Jalade Dasharate Kamaniyanana Sugunanide, Karuna Jalade Dasharate Kamaniyanana Sugunanide. Now, let us shift the same thing to the normal sa. Karuna jalade dasharate kamaniyanana sugunanide. Karuna jalade dasharate kamaniyanana sugunanide. Going back to the original Madhyama Shruti, sama karuna jalade dasharate kamaniyanana sugunanide. Where you saw that the tonal quality there sounded brighter, that's the only reason. And obviously, since there are only limited notes, it's easy to sing in the Madhyama Shruti also. This applies to other ragams also, like Shenjuruti and Punnagavarali. In this context, we also see that ragas like Sindhu Bhairavi and Yamuna Kalyani, for example, we see that these songs also in this particular ragam, like for example, Bhavayami Gopala Balam, which you hear in Yamuna Kalyani, is generally sung in the Madhyama Shruti. So what I want to really tell here is that in all these kinds of ragas which you're talking about, the range is very, very limited. So it makes it much easier for us in terms of singing the Madhyama Shruti. Secondly, of course, when you sing it in the Madhyama Shruti, it sounds a lot more brighter in terms of the presentation. Thank you very much for asking questions, and I hope that you'll continue to ask us more questions so that we also put on our thinking caps and try to do more research on these subjects. See you again in the next episode with some more very interesting topics. Thank you very much.